Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by congratulating the Cabinet Secretary on her reappointment and also by congratulating both Maureen Watt and Aileen Campbell on their appointments. I welcome the tenor of the Government's motion, acknowledging as it does the multifarious challenges we face in delivering a healthier Scotland and, importantly, recognising the need for a joined-up and collaborative approach in meeting those challenges. I'd also like to welcome the creation of a dedicated position for mental health. I know this is something for which there is a great deal of cross-party support, and it does, in my opinion, signal the clear intent of this administration to bring a long overdue parity between mental and physical health. Indeed, mental health must be a national priority. Speaking as the son of a retired psychiatric nurse, I am keenly aware of the incredible work that our mental health clinicians and staff perform. I look forward to seeing the development and details and implementation of the proposed mental health strategy, and I welcome the commitment to increase mental health spending to over £1 billion by 2020. I also welcome the commitment to invest £4 million per year in the recruitment of 100 mental health link workers in Scotland's most deprived areas. It's vital that those in need are able to quickly access service providers, like, for example, Recovery Across Mental Health, who provide support to many people in my constituency of Renfrewshire South. Such organisations are invaluable, and we must continue to do all we can to support them. Presiding Officer, in this debate, as in many others, we must, of course, consider the challenges posed to society by growing inequality. We are all aware of the complexity of the reasons behind health inequalities. My own constituency of Renfrewshire South has been subject to many of the challenges faced by post-industrial communities in the west of Scotland. Compared to the national average, people in Renfrewshire South are more likely to be admitted to hospital, and there are significantly more alcohol-related hospital stays than the Scottish average. The government's recognition that health inequalities will require an approach that looks beyond the NHS and that roots activity to address inequalities across government is to be welcomed, and I look forward to seeing how this principle continues to inform proposals on the use of the new social security powers coming to this Parliament. But it's important to remember, however, that for too many, inequality begins in the womb. I'm delighted that this government has taken important steps to address this through the rolling out of baby boxes and the recent announcement that by next spring, all pregnant women will receive free vitamins. This builds on the work already undertaken by this government to address neonatal inequality, such as seeking to overcome the barriers to breastfeeding that too many women face. Here, as with mental health, we must acknowledge the work of the third sector in making Scotland healthier. This weekend passed at the outstanding Lily's Day event in Kilbarkin, I met Melanie and Hazel from the Breastfeeding Network. The Breastfeeding Network does outstanding work in communities like Johnston, Linwood and Kilbarkin, and supporting mothers to make informed decisions about breastfeeding and providing access to help when they need it. It's vital that we continue to support organisations like the Breastfeeding Network to ensure that they continue to play an active role in making our communities healthier. I'd like to conclude, Presiding Officer, by addressing those who would challenge the principle that the NHS should be free at the point of use. In particular, those in this chamber who were elected on a commitment to reintroduce prescription charges. Though, admittedly, they have been decidedly more coy in this matter since being elected than during the campaign. The arguments adduced in support of this proposition, if I may summarise, invariably follow the formula of asking why someone on a high salary should be exempted from paying a nominal fee for medication prescribed by a GP. It's contended that such a charge would provide a welcome source of revenue and would be entirely compatible with the principle of fairness, as only those capable of affording the fee would be required to pay it. Now, one could respond to such an argument by highlighting how the previous system of prescription charges saw many on low incomes slip through the net and consequently be subject to paying charges that they struggled to afford. One could also raise the question of how much of that fee would actually reach frontline resource budgets once it had been through the bureaucratic ringer of means testing. However, as important and valid as these technical critiques are, it is my view that the most fundamental objection to prescription charges is that they undermine the universalism that must be a motivating ideal in the delivery of all our public services, especially our NHS. Universalism is not an ideal that is easy to realise. but it serves as a beacon to us. It shows that our minds and thinking are not bounded by the present, that we dare to imagine the kind of truly equal society that we can and will be. Presiding Officer, over the coming Parliament and indeed the coming decade, like many countries, Scotland will face great challenges in the delivery of health and care services. But it is clear that this government recognises those challenges, and it is clear that this government has the ideas and the vision to deliver the healthier Scotland that we all seek.